Yesu!
Bethel Wafula, HIV, DNA, PCR results is negative!
April 2nd, the year 2004. In fact, between 2 p.m. to 4 p.m., it was a tremendous long conversation. The Lord lifted me up and I found myself standing before the throne of God. When I was standing before the throne of God, the glory of the Lord had covered the throne like a mountain. And He made me know that he that sits on the throne was indeed seated on the throne. That he made me know, even as the glory covered the throne. So as I stood there, I knew that he was there. And then the second thing he made me know was this. He also made me know that he was paying particular attention to everything that was going to happen here, where I was standing. And between me and the throne, there was tremendous glory that covered the entire place. The entire. Between me and the throne, there was a very minor ridge. There was only one small ridge that seemed to have separated from where I was and the throne. And that minor ridge had the glory, but you could see that this is a ridge. Can I move on now? Next. And then as I was standing there, all of a sudden, John the Baptist appeared on my right hand side. Can we move on now? That's why I asked whether you're mature enough to take these things. Listen, John the Baptist appeared on my right hand side. And he went there, went back here. I think I've described on the web all this. And then he turned and began to speak with me. And he told me to go tell the four ends of the earth to prepare for the coming of the Lord. Listen, let's move on step by step. Listen. As he told me that, he also said, the Lamb of God who was slain for the sin of man was coming soon. Listen. And then, at that particular moment when he said that, I don't know why, somehow I did not understand well what he had said. I developed a little argument with him before the throne. Because I asked him, why did he have to die? Did he really have to die? And then he said, never mind. It was the will of the Father that he dies. And so, there was that little, I still remember that little contestation between me and him on that. I don't know why, I didn't know, I felt like, did he really, was there no other way to do this? That is when I saw a vision within a vision. That's when the Lord now showed me the day when the Lamb was slain. I cannot share the full detail, but I saw. And when I saw, when the Lamb was slain, it struck me. And then the voice from the throne said, listen, follow very carefully, I'm going step by step. Then the voice from the throne said, let me show you what is about to happen. And I remember, the Lord lifted me from there and took me to Israel. And when, up from above, so I was seeing from above, The first thing I saw was Arafat's tomb. Big tomb, big. It was fresh, it has just been dug fresh. Arafat's tomb. And from above, from the way the Lord took me above, so I was seeing all over. So he took me around the Arab world, and this is what I saw. I saw light, light, light in the homes. It was in the night. I saw light, light, light lamps in the homes. And this is what I heard. I heard mourning, 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 mourning in the Arab world. That's the first thing I saw. 2004, before he died. The next thing I saw, when I was above, I know I've added one part I did not add in Sydney. Yeah, so you've got it, yes. In Sydney I hid it, now you have it. Okay, now listen to this. When I was still there, then he shows me Jerusalem. And the voice said, yes, Jerusalem is the center of the earth. don't continue with me. I'm looking at them for a reason. Look at this. The voice said, yes, Jerusalem is the center of the earth. But now look at this. The next thing I saw in Jerusalem, I saw a change of leadership take place in Jerusalem. And when I saw a change of leadership take place in Jerusalem, everybody following me very close. That's why I asked whether you are mature enough to take these things. When I saw the change of leadership take place in Jerusalem, the first one, then I saw a second change of leadership take place in Jerusalem. But when the second change of leadership took place in Jerusalem, then the Lord took me to all the major capitals of the world. All over the world from above like this. And I saw how there was anxiety across the whole world. Because they were saying, how this is a right-wing government. How will we discuss the peace of Palestine with them? So there was anxiety in the whole world, all the capitals of the world. Anxiety consumed them. The Lord took me to the capitals of the world. I was seeing how all the leadership across the world was saying, how will we discuss peace with these people, the peace of Palestine? That's after the second change. But listen to this now. Everybody following this. Then, as he still lifted me up above the clouds, then I saw aircrafts in the sky. Going where? To Israel. And when I saw aircrafts going to Israel, for me, it's different. For those who came before me, when they saw this, it was different also. But for me, let me explain what he showed me. When I saw aircrafts, step by step, I've given so many now, but you're following, right? When I saw aircrafts going to Israel, he made me see through the windows of the aircrafts up in the sky, in the clouds there, from where he had lifted me. Through the window, I saw Christians, and he put there particular Christians for me to know these were Christians. Going where? To Jerusalem, to Israel, in aircrafts. Just continue with me here. So when I saw that, then again, the next part of that vision, I found myself back standing before the mighty throne of God. But, listen to this now. As I was standing before the mighty throne of God, I realized, John the Baptist had not left. He was still here. And then, at that moment, when I realized he was still here, when I looked at him, everybody here, when I looked at him and looked at his raiment, it became transfigured. His clothes became super glorious. In fact, to the extent that it was shocking, because the Lord made me know that if I had a pen and I touched his garment with a pen, it would, you would see it. That's how super glorious his garment became. I'm now sharing very sensitive stuff with this church. I shared with the Kenyan church. It matured them, this kind of conversation. Remember, he's coming for a mature bride, right? Okay. You'd rather get used to handling this kind of matter, right? Oh, yes. It's time for infants. Time for infancy is out. Infancy, right? Can we mature? Okay. So, his raiment became transfigured. So when I looked at my raiment, it had also become transfigured. It had become glorified. Can I move to the next level? That is when all of a sudden, from where he was standing, he raised his right hand like this towards the throne. And then he said, "Behold the Lamb of God." And then the glory of the throne from this side opened. And the most glorious, mighty Lamb of God came out. I'm going to share only where I'm allowed to share. When he began to come, everything became super glorious, including where we're standing. And I don't know why I could hear, I heard almost like a hissing sound of glory. As it was coming. At that point, I could almost hear a hissing sound of the glory of the Lord. Hallelujah. I could almost hear a hissing sound of the glory of the Lord at that time. And then, at that point, as the most glorious lamp came, as he turned to me, let me add one more thing. Then the ridge disappeared. Let me stop there. I cannot discuss more than that point. Can I share now on something there? I want to focus on this glorious garment. Hallelujah. What happened is this. I was going all over the world giving this prophecy. And then all of a sudden, the pastors began to call me from across the globe, from the Western Hemisphere, the whatever. They began to tell me, "Man of God, have you watched your news?" I said, "What is it?" "The first change of government has taken..." First of all, they said, "Arafat has died." No, he's sick, rather. He's sick. First became sick. "Man of God, have you watched your news? The first part is fulfilled. Arafat has died." As we went on, again, phone calls came. "Man of God." But when I gave the prophecy in Kenya in 2005, I told them from McKinney School, I said, "This second change of leadership is going to be Benjamin Netanyahu Poo." 2005 from McKinney School in Kenya, in Lovington. And I said, the first Benjamin Netanyahu took place when I was in Israel. And I was telling them, "The Lord has made me know it is going to be Benjamin Netanyahu too. He's going to come back." So I was telling people all over. And so, the death of Arafat took place. And then, all of a sudden, Ariel Sharon, the prime minister, falls sick. Are you following me right now? This is sensitive stuff I'm giving you from the throne. The Lord has loved you. Before we come to this, you need to know these things. In them is embedded the secrets of God. And then, I think he was discussing peace and whatever. But he became sick. Okay, in Gaza, wherever. And so, then the first change of leadership took place. "Man of God, are you watching your news? The first change of leadership has taken place." And so, after that, come 2008, man of God, are you watching your news? Christians are going to Jerusalem. Can you turn with me to the book of Isaiah chapter 60, verse 8? It's time to do it in this place, because Pastor Crawford has brought me here. I have to give it. This is the hour. Isaiah 60 verse 8. Are we ready? Who are these that fly along like clouds, like doves, to their nests? Everybody focus on me again. When the Lord showed this very dream to Isaiah, aircrafts had not been invented. Not yet. And so, Isaiah saw they were flying with the clouds, and look, every time people are in an aircraft, everybody look at me now, even yesterday as we're coming, it's about what? The neck. Whether you are in the aisle seat, window seat, whatever, everybody's always checking through the window, where have we reached? Do you understand what Isaiah saw? Isaiah, now look at the birds in their nests. When the birds are in their nests, they are always looking through the lattices. Who is coming? Whatever. Did you understand what Isaiah saw? And he saw them flying with the cloud, and he knew that these were not Israelites. That's why he asked. He said, flying like the cloud. He said, who are these that fly along like clouds, like doves, to their nests? For me, when the Lord shows me this, the aircraft has been invented. I can see it. And I can see the Christians inside. But Isaiah saw them look like doves. Holy Spirit. Israel was celebrating, I think, 60th anniversary or something. Then a lot of aircraft. Then I watched the news. I followed the news. They were saying this is the highest number of touchdowns of aircrafts we have seen since the state was created. Some of you may have gone there. That's another prophecy fulfilled. But then when Ariel Sharon was sick, Ehud Olmert came up. Ehud Olmert continued. He began to talk peace again. And I heard that he was sick also. And then there was some scandal also. Then all of a sudden, Benjamin Netanyahu came. But even me, I was shocked, by the way. I have to confess this. I was shocked by something here. Let me tell you what shocked me. There was a development that shocked me, because I did not know he was supposed to go to election. I did not know it was supposed to be Benjamin Netanyahu 2 of 2. That part also shocked me, because they went to election and he came back. Hallelujah. Benjamin Netanyahu came back to become prime minister. Then again, they went to elections, he came back. But one thing that caught my attention was this. When he came to power, he chose Avigdor Lieberman as the Minister for Foreign Affairs. And so I saw the whole world having difficulty in engaging with him. Hallelujah. I think even now, I've not watched news. Has he come back? Because he was cleared again and he has come back. Yeah, yeah. Now listen to this. In that vision, after the second change, and I came back to the throne, in front of the throne. After the second change, then the raiments became glorious. Are you with me? Step by step. After the second change in Jerusalem, and I came back before the throne, the raiments became glorious. Let me continue. After the second change, and the raiments became glorious, then he said, behold the Lamb of God. If you didn't understand, I won't explain anymore. Did somebody hear me? Sometimes you people have what you call an awful silence. No, it's okay. It's okay. It's meant to bring you people on board. An awful silence, you know. Israel feared that silence, right? Now, listen to me. And I said, nobody should confuse what I've said. Because what remains is this. Nobody knows the day or the hour. But all I've said is this. When I saw the second change, then I also saw him come. So I did not say that he came during the change, during the second change. I did not say that. I did not say he came after the second change. I did not say that. I only said this. I saw the second change and behold the Lamb. Did you understand? You need to prepare your garments. So listen, precious people. I am sharing another vision of the garment. Another one. I am traveling to Venezuela. And I fall asleep on the floor of the airport in South Africa, Johannesburg. Oh yes. Because, you know, sometimes Jesus never had a home. On the rock, the Mount of Olives, he rested his ribs there. Sometimes things happen when God calls you, right? So when I was there in the midst of the busy airport, then I saw the visions of the Lord. I saw the coming of the pale horse, the prophecy that gave birth to this bloodshed, Tunisia, Cairo, Syria, whatever, down the line. However, I also saw something else. I saw, for the first time, when the church has been taken and she's inside heaven. That was my first time to see the church inside heaven. I have seen the Lord take the church. That I've seen, I think, about four times. But I had never seen the church inside heaven. Can I describe? I saw them, and they were dancing, not dancing, but worshiping in unison. They were worshiping in unison, in one accord. The most beautiful worship ever. Listen to me. And when they went all together on one side, their garments, let me describe the garment. It was long, reached down, and flowed a little bit. It's called the train of the garment. A little bit flowed. And as they worshipped, they went on one side. From where the Lord had lifted me, the glory began to flash on me like flashes. 1,000 cameras flashing like this. Flashing on me. That's how the glory was radiating from the garment. Listen, precious people. I want to stop there and read a scripture and explain those visions. Hallelujah. In each of those visions is a glorious garment. Turn with me to the book of Exodus 28. Exodus 28. From verse 1. He says, have Aaron, your brother, brought to you from among the Israelites, along with his sons, Nadab and Abihu, Eleazar and Ithamar, so that they may serve me as priests. How are we there? Verse 2. It says, make sacred garments for your brother Aaron to give him dignity and honor. If you read other versions, they say, make sacred garments for your brother Aaron to give him beauty and glory. Other versions give that differently. Glory for, you see that? Glory for beauty. Dignity and honor. Hallelujah. And further on, look what he says, verse 3. He goes on to say verse 3. Tell all the skilled men to whom I have given this wisdom, in such matters, that they are to make sacred garments for Aaron for his consecration, so he may serve me as priest. And he, so beyond there, he describes the details of the making of the garment, the breastplate, the everything, right? Listen very carefully. Aaron was living in the camp. He was living with everybody else in the camp. Normal life, usual life, casual life. He was there. But when the time arrived in God's calendar, God's timeline, when the time arrived for Aaron to now appear before the Lord, then all of a sudden, this is what you hear. The Lord now begins to give instruction to Moses, and this is the instruction. Let Aaron be brought out, meaning be separated out. Did you understand? When the time to appear arrives, the first thing the Lord commands is separation. Number two, follow me. He says, to be brought out, and now it's as though there is a protocol. It's as though there must be a dressing code. When it's time to appear before the Lord, he now talks about a sacred garment that should give him dignity and honor, glory for beauty. Meaning, when he's doing casual here in the camp, he has no dignity and honor before the Lord. Are you still together with me? Step by step. New Zealand has to be spoken to, right? Oh yes, this church needs to be spoken to. And I think today there is a significant speaking too happening here. Very significant. Today you even said women can't come with trousers anymore in church. Oh yes. He is not politically correct, no? No, he don't care, right? He only cares about him, eh? Listen. He says, when it's time to appear before the Lord, there now appears a dressing protocol. A dressing requirement. And he's saying that that dressing would give dignity. You read further on, he says, for his consecration. Do you know what consecration means? You do, I'm sure. Because what happened was this. They had a turban, and there was a folding there, and a writing inside. And that writing said, holy unto the Lord. Meaning, separated unto the Lord. Oh, yes. The moment of truth has dawned on you now. He's saying that Aaron now needs a garment, a sacred garment, so he can get favor before God. So when he appears, he's favorable. Favor. I went to Haiti and said, earthquake is coming. And earthquake happened. I went to Chile and said, earthquake is coming. Live on TV, Global TV, TV and Televisión Nacional de Chile. Earthquake is coming. And earthquake happened. I went to Brisbane. I went wherever and said, global economic crisis is coming. And global economic crisis happened. Listen. I said here today that I have seen the church appear before the throne worship. That means it will happen. Does somebody understand me? It is not a joke. The same time. That's why he makes those earthquakes happen. That they may know that even this big one he says will happen. Those prophecies being fulfilled are not for nothing. They're not for Hollywood. No. They are all linked to the coming of the Lord. Even when I say, I see a little child, a cripple, going to be healed. I see one who cannot talk, some a lot of detail that I see. And I say them, and those people appear in the meeting there. There is a message there about the coming of the Messiah. Everything is now, right now, about the coming of the Messiah. His warning is saying, be careful. Therefore, whatever he says will come to pass. Even the coming of the Messiah will happen. Oh, that's the day I will dance. That's the day you'll understand this rusty man that used to come from Africa. And that's the day I will tell you that is what I meant when I told you prepare. And I hope I don't live to tell you that. Listen to this. Listen very carefully. I need to cover this very well. He's saying that when the time to appear before the throne comes, there is a garment. And he's saying, as for Aaron and Moses, he told Moses that there is a skillful one. There are some people who have skill. The Holy Spirit, God has released unto them the wisdom to prepare this garment. And Moses, if you follow, went to them and they prepared the exact garment the Lord needed. Because the Lord had downloaded that program to them. How to prepare that sacred anointing garment. Anointed garment. And right now in the church, in New Zealand, first of all, we are about to appear. This meeting here today is calling upon the church to prepare to appear. And that means she needs a garment. And he's saying, if she needs this garment, however, there is somebody that has been given the skill to prepare that garment. Are you with me? And when I look at the church in New Zealand, I see that you have not yet engaged him. You have not yet engaged him on the matters of the garment. And that's why when I landed in Gisborne yesterday, I said, why is it so quiet here? Does it mean these people, then they are not going to heaven? What is the problem here? Because I expected to see movement. as I see in Kenya. I've never seen such a thing. Everybody's calling the radio. Everybody's looking for where to be baptized. Everybody's saying, how can I walk holier? They're changing dressing. They're changing their ways. They're changing their talk. They're changing their what. They're changing everything. And this past weekend, something came up. Yesterday, something came up. Thousands and thousands of people that have been living without marriage went to repent and asked to be baptized and asked to be taught marriage and to be united according to the Bible. I received a report yesterday. So, people are deliberately preparing to appear. Deliberately, intentionally. Which means putting an effort, not just some, going with the wave. No. There has to be a deliberate preparation here. And he's saying that that garment, can I shock you? That garment was prepared in Isaiah 53. You saw the travail of the Lord on the cross to give you that garment for free. But if you dirten that garment, then you see what happened to Israel in Zechariah chapter 3, verses 1 to 6 happening to you. When Israel appeared before the Lord. That Joshua you see there, that is Israel, appeared before the Lord. And when he appeared before the Lord, the garment was filthy. And when the garment was filthy, the enemy also appeared here to claim him, to claim her. Until the Lord rebukes the enemy. Lord, rebuke you. Isn't this man a stick, a burning stick snatched from the fire? And then later he tells him, he tells the people, the angels, remove his filthy garment. Give him the glorious garment. That is when the garment has been filthified, soiled. What does that mean? When the garment is soiled in the church, the enemy claims right over the church. So you understand where your problems came from. The enemy has claimed right over the church. Historic right, legal right, birthright, whatever right. Glorious garment, radiant garment. And the person the church in New Zealand ought to have been speaking with now is the Holy Spirit. Only he has the skill. He is delegated to prepare her and present her. Did you understand me? What is the meaning of that? That means the Lord is saying that the wedding rings in the sky are actually spiritual wedding rings. And if they are spiritual wedding rings, that means the Lord is saying he is now looking for a purified church, a golden church that is worthy of wearing those rings. He's saying, if these wedding rings are spiritual wedding rings, then essentially they're announcing the spiritual dispensation in the church. The dispensation of the Holy Spirit. When I came to Kenya, they did not even worship the Holy Spirit. I began to teach messages on my interaction with the person of the Holy Spirit. I began to teach some deep messages when the person of the Holy Spirit appears to me, talks with me, does. I began to teach that. And then, now, the church that is there has a reliance on the Holy Spirit. But then, no, before we clap, how about New Zealand? That means I have come to announce to you that now the Lord is looking for a spiritual church. I don't have time to read 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verses 50 to 56, where he says, I tell you the truth, flesh and blood will not inherit the kingdom of God. And he says, the corruptible must be converted into the incorruptible. And he says, the perishable must be transformed into imperishability. He says, the mortal must convert into immortality. Hallelujah. Precious people, the message of the two golden wedding rings in the sky is essentially the announcement of the wedding of the Lamb of God. And the Lord is saying, I know you love your country. I know it's beautiful here. But he's saying, now it is time to prepare for another kingdom. Hallelujah. And I want you to appreciate that we must be a blessed generation to even, you know what shocked me most was that I gave the prophecy, and when it came to pass, people even recorded it and had it in camera and put it on YouTube. So this only speaks of a very blessed generation. How dare we even discuss him? You understand? Yeah, it raises the question, who are we? This must be a blessed church, blessed generation, a blessed dispensation. Even to be able to capture him and have it on your camera, right? So after, when I discuss that, I will be winding down tomorrow evening. Tomorrow evening I'll be winding down with some two other conversations. The rapture of the dead and the golden clock he showed me in the sky. The Bible says, nobody knows the day or the hour. Not even the Messiah, not even the angels. Then why did he show me the clock? We will see tomorrow what time it is out there. Mighty Father, I want to thank you today that you have spoken to these people, your church, your pastors. And Lord, you've spoken in a very, very stern way, owing to the gravity of these events. And I ask you, my Father, to quicken their hearts. Yes. That, Lord, they may perceive, that they may perceive the gravity of this and the urgency of this. Lord, I ask that even as this first seed is being laid on this ground of New Zealand from here, that it will grow and give birth to revival that will eat the whole of this nation. Father, you love them, and that is the reason you speak to them. And I'm asking you, my Father, to prevail upon them, to enable them, to unite them, strengthen them, zeal them up, that they may be able to carry this vision and run throughout this land. Because today,